Life's too short to drive boring cars.
So there's so many great cars on the market. Whether you want a luxury sedan or you want an SUV or a sports car or a minivan or a truck, whatever that is, there's lots of great options. Even with this crisis, there's still some great selections. But the key being, you don't want to lose your shirt on depreciation. You don't want to spend your hard-earned dollars on maintenance and servicing and repairs when you don't have to. So really the best bet is just to buy a vehicle that's not going to cost you an arm and 3.5 legs in the first place so that you can keep all that money in your pocket for a rainy day or for some other little venture. Well, I'm gonna share a list of 5 vehicles that are guaranteed to keep you broke, and you're definitely gonna wanna avoid these 5 vehicles to prevent financial ruin. Let's get into it now. So the first one on my list is what we have parked back here, and it's the BMW E60 M5. If you've been following me for some time, you know I actually personally own one, and that's how I came to my conclusion on these are one of the most financially ruining vehicles on the used car market. And while some critics call this Jekyll and Hyde for its performance, I also call it Jekyll and Hyde for its cost of maintenance. Why is that? Because some days it can be a great luxury vehicle, can cost you nothing, you can drive like that for months, and then all of a sudden, wham, you get destroyed with a whole host of different costs. But let's take a quick look. I mean, the E60 M5 right there, absolutely beautiful vehicle. I personally believe these are the nicest M5 ever produced for styling. You've got quad exhaust tips, you've got that rear diffuser down there, 19-inch wheels, although chrome isn't really the best color. You've got the infamous M badging, and of course, because it's the M series of E60, you'll notice it's got more flair than the rest of the E60 lineup. It also has a more pronounced rocker panel, which is consistent specifically for the M5. And most of them come with a sunroof, classic emblem, and as well, the old kidney style grille. You'll notice, of course, you've got the conventional headlight arrangement, but the E60 has this little extra brow that a lot of the other cars in that era didn't have. Go right here, we have aggressive spoiler. They're a very, very attractive car, and they perform well. I mean, with 507 brake horsepower, there's not much in its day that can compete with this. I mean, they were competitive with the likes of the Ferrari 430, Lamborghini Gallardo. They're an absolute beast. 0-60 in 4 seconds. Top speed, 203 miles per hour if you remove the governor. 7-speed SMG single clutch automated gearbox, and the rest goes on and on. This car is absolutely amazing. It's got the active bolsters and it's got heads up display. So what's not to like about these? First of all, the SMG pump vano system starts to get rattly. The throttle actuators, which I've had to replace some on my car personally, can cost you about $4,000 parts and labor if you'd have to do the pair of them. The rear differential, which is electronic, is also very fragile, as is the rest of the car. So it's not uncommon to have to replace a differential to the tune of several thousand dollars. But the big problem with these cars is the engine. While it's one of the best sounding and best performing naturally aspirated high revving V10 engines on the market, the problem is the rod bearings. At the bottom of the engine, the bearings that couple the connecting rod to the crankshaft, those bearings prematurely wear. When they do, the engine goes boom! And that instantly turns a $40,000 car into an $8,000 car. A used engine that somebody found in the scrapyard might cost you $20,000, 25 grand to retrofit. If you had to rebuild that engine from top to bottom, could cost you 40 or 50 grand. It is F1 inspired after all. We won't even talk about the oversized cross-drilled rotors or the clutches that go out every 80 to 100,000 kilometers. These cars will always cost you a lot of money, and the dollar per kilometer rating of these is huge. It's through the roof. So it's one of those vehicles, unless you really, really have a love for that car, I'd recommend staying away from it because it will financially ruin you. Now the next financially ruining vehicle is similar to the one I have behind me here. Now this is the newer version. It's the Porsche Boxster 718. This is the newer one with the turbo 4-cylinder engine. These have been a little bit improved, but it's the older ones that I'm speaking of that have the naturally aspirated flat 6 engine. But let's do a quick look around even this one here as an example. Well, the Boxsters have always been very, very true to their design element, and that is, you know, small, sporty, lightweight, fun, well-balanced sports car by Porsche that was an entry-level, easy to buy for the mainstream, and very, very exciting. Now, it came out in 1997 with a flat 6 engine and a 5-speed manual gearbox. In recent years now, you can get PDKs, you can get manuals. Now again, 4-cylinder turbos have replaced the flat 6, but it is the flat 6 engine that was a problem. But let's take a quick look. First of all, they always have great rims, and they have wonderful mirrors and a nice little soft top just to keep things simple and the weight down. Of course, here now we have a mid-engine design. We have the gearbox between the wheels and the engines in front of the gearbox. That's mid-engine. On the 911, the gearbox is here and the engine's out back. So there's a difference, and that's why they call the 911 a rear engine. Here we have the 718 Boxster S, and they have some great new lights. And the newer style is certainly a lot fresher than the older vehicles. They all have some sort of inlets, soft touch, and the interiors are very, very well designed and high quality. But unfortunately, even my wife fell in love with the Boxster and she'd like to buy one too. We've got on a bit of a mission trying to hunt for one. We went and shopped around for quite a few and found some used ones, but every single time we were grossly disappointed because they're not well made. They don't look well crafted. There's lots of plastics. They look very plain Jane, and quite frankly, every single car didn't seem to wear well. The seat bolsters were cracked and worn out. And the big problem with the way they wear and the way they look is the depreciation, because everybody knows that there's inherent problems. And that inherent issue is the infamous IMS bearing problem. That's the intermediate shaft. Now, that's not unique to the Boxster from 97 and up generation. It also goes consistent with the 996 Porsche 911 as well, which shares the same style of headlights. Here's a 996. They also potentially have the IMS bearing issue. Now, it's not a mass percentage. It's not a 50-50 ratio, but there's enough of these cars, well more than enough documentation on the internet, as well as people that I personally know that have experienced IMS failures. And when that happens, it lets go. The bearing releases all kinds of shrapnel within the engine and the oiling, and then you wind up with a situation where often the engine needs to be thrown out or completely rebuilt from top to bottom with a thorough cleansing. So it's a very expensive proposition, and sadly on a Boxster now that you can find for $6,000-$8,000 and you have to do a $15,000 or $20,000 engine job, that's why the values stay low and you'll lose a ton of money if you buy one at a higher cost and suffer the potential fate of an IMS failure. Now the next disaster on my list will likely financially ruin you if you have to keep up with all the maintenance and repairs that these things slam at you. It's the Dodge Caravan right here. And there we have a Caravan. As you can see, it's the kind of vehicle that families love because they can haul all their kids in there, throw the dog and the beach equipment and all the junk. They might even be able to haul small trailers, maybe that little utility trailer with your small project for your yard. It is the Grand Caravan by Dodge. And as well, the Town and Country. Now these vehicles are absolutely super easy to live with, and that's why people love them, because there's lots of space. The height to get in is easy for people. It's easy to slide right in for older people, bigger people, smaller people. It's a good mid-size vehicle for that. So that's why people love these minivans. But the unfortunate part is these things are a heap. They're poorly made. We all know by now that Fiat, Chrysler, Jeep together as a conglomeration has built some real winners over the years. But let's talk about some of the problems. Other than leaks, loose front ends that get all clunky and bangy after a few short miles on some of these rough pothole ridden roads, because they're not built all that well. So they're built light duty, almost like a lawn tractor, and they start getting loose with few short miles. The big problem is transmission issues on some of the earlier models. I know somebody that actually owned one of these older versions and had the 3.3 liter V6 engine, and literally with less than 90,000 kilometers on it, bang! The transmission blew a hole right in the bottom, dumped all the fluid, and of course the quote to replace that transmission was more than that entire junker was worth, so the whole vehicle was sent off to pasture. Now the interior can be slightly dressed up. In this model it looks a little nicer, but really it's not much more than a Glad garbage bag pulled tightly over some cheap foam. And that's a good one, because some of the earlier, more base models look like Tupperware got a hold of those and actually redesigned the full interior. Also, many of the older ones, the original early vintage, the K-car style, the early generation Caravans, even the second and third generation vehicles had problems with heavy oil consumption. They just started burning at a relatively low miles. Poorly built, under-engineered, and quite frankly, if you paid to fix everything on this vehicle to keep it nicely running on the road, it would run you to financial ruin, just because the vehicle's not worth much more than a bucket of pucks. And the next heap on my list is actually what we have back here, and it's a Mazda RX-8. I mean, they're great looking vehicles. When these first came out, I was excited. I was totally pumped because I actually had a 1988 Mazda RX-7 with the twin Wankel engine. This vehicle also has the twin rotor engine as well by Wankel. As you can see, even the little headrests in there show that little triangle to indicate this is the Wankel engine. Now they're great. They have beautiful headlights. Quite frankly, a very nicely styled car. At a time when everything looks very, very bland, it's nice to see something with a little style. I mean, look at even these fenders. Look at the hips on that. Absolutely looks awesome. It's a great looking car there. Come down the side, and of course now you've got this rear suicide door that flips open this way. And of course you've always got some decent rims, although these are aftermarket. Some of them obviously have the wing on board, which gives it a little bit of a sporty touch. And you've got these interesting little tail lights. But I really like the rear finish of these vehicles as well. Looks sharp. And again, we've got that triangular symbol to replicate the rotary engine. Why do we have water in the taillights? Because that's just part of the problem. But that's not the big problem. Back when I drove my car in 1988, the car was great. I loved it. It was a 5-speed manual, twin Rankel. It was a lot of fun. 146 horsepower. Didn't exactly win a lot of races, but it was great fun. Then came the twin turbo. That was absolutely one of my dream cars. I enjoyed that. I drove it a few times. I was gonna buy one, a little bit out of my reach at the time, but then I moved on. I kind of lost my love affair for Mazda for a while. Then this thing came along and I reignited it. I thought, hey, I should get one of those. They look great. I love this style. But then, you know what? I started hearing of some of the issues, engine failures. And the problem with these vehicles, again, is the heavy depreciation. They take a nosedive in value, so you lose a significant amount of money just buying it and selling it within 3 or 4 years. But the bigger problem is the Wankel engine. And usually what ends up happening is it starts heavy oil consumption, or the vehicle just won't start because it doesn't build enough compression. And those are the key indicators that your seals on the apexes of that Wankel are toast and they're ready for the garbage. So sadly enough, as nice as these are with the high revving Wankel engines and the sportiness and all the styling behind it, Mazda just couldn't quite get that engine fully refined, and it's gonna cost you 2 arms and 5 legs to keep that thing on the road. Now the next disaster on top of a heap of disasters that will likely cause you financial ruin potentially is the Volkswagen Tiguan. Now, a lot of people like these vehicles. They look quite interesting. They're small, they're stout. Volkswagen, everybody associate them with high quality German made products. And here's another one with these big, great bulbous headlights and a funky little fog light. How about the side? Not too much there. Very plain vanilla yogurt going on here all the way down. And then we finish with a very standard looking type of taillight. Certainly one of the more basic products from the VAG group. It does have some plastic protection where it counts along the bumper and of course around the fenders and as well the rocker. So that's all gonna protect these vehicles from rock, debris, and all the other kind of shrapnel that come off the roads. Now it does have a great little dual pipe, but you'll notice there's carbon buildup there. Not uncommon for these vehicles. Especially we're talking about the 2.0 TSI 4Motion, that's the all-wheel drive. And the interior is extremely basic. Certainly it is a price point car, that's pretty clear. Not even a sunroof on this particular car, but this other one you do. So obviously you can get different degrees of options. This one here obviously has roof racks, so you can haul all kinds of loads to the dump and garbage and drywall and plywood. This one here is certainly outfitted a little better. And even the tailpipes look a little cleaner on there, which tells me that there could be a running issue with this one over this one. This one looks to be a little leaner. So what kind of problems do you have with these? But first, let's start out by saying customers were surveyed. And did you realize these ranked 23 out of 25 Volkswagen products for reliability? In other words, they're almost dead last. They're supremely unreliable and generally don't get great reviews from owners. So what are the big problems here? Well, one being the clock spring. So you have that spring that follows your steering wheel that connects your electrics from your airbag through to the electronics of the vehicle. So the airbag spring has been a consistent issue with a lot of Volkswagen products. I owned a Volkswagen Golf myself years ago, and that spring went kaput as well, and thus it yields the airbag inoperative. I also know somebody who owned one of these, and every time they rounded the corner, the heater, they would start blowing cold air in the wintertime. It was almost like as the coolant would slosh around, you'd get air in the system and you'd wind up with cool air flowing through the heater box, resulting in all kinds of inconsistencies in the heating and cooling. That is a common issue. These also have lots of issues with coolant and engine oil leaks as well. But another huge issue with these vehicles is there was an actual class action lawsuit which identified timing chain issues where they potentially came loose because of some bad tensioners and ramps, and you wound up with a catastrophic engine failure. And what do you think when the timing chain skips a cog? Boom! That's right, it actually blows the engine, because these engines are interference engine. In other words, if the pistons and the valves aren't aligned, they can actually collide with each other if the timing chain doesn't keep them in synchronization. And that's a big dollar bill. Of course, you're talking $10,000, $15,000 for a rebuilt engine on these vehicles. Another problem is the Takata airbags, which unfortunately is a subcontractor issue, and many manufacturers had that issue, so that was well known. And another problem was ignition coil failures, too many to mention. As a matter of fact, it was too consistent to not identify with. So you'd get rough running, poor starting, or stalling altogether if your ignition didn't provide the spark to keep the engine running smoothly. And with all of that said, be sure to click on that video. You're gonna wanna know about some of the worst engines on the market today. That's gonna tell you all about it. Hope to see you real soon. Catch you then. Bye-bye.